It's been cold, very cold, like in the teens and 20s cold. But it's also dry. There's no snow or mud, and if you're like me, you want to ride. As a kid, I loved playing outside in the cold. Snow days were the best days. As they say, there's no such thing as bad weather, just bad clothing. Well, I don't know about that, but here are a few tips that I've learned that might make your ride more enjoyable as the temperature drops. Okay, so let me provide a little disclaimer. There are tons of great cold weather cycling products on the market, but I want to use the stuff that I already have in my closet. The stuff I bought for hiking, camping, or whatever. I paid good money for it, so that's what I'm focusing on here. First of all, the secret is in the layers. Three basic layers, actually. The base layer, think underwear and shirts. The insulation layer, and the protective shell. The beauty in this system is you can easily shed and re-add layers as the conditions change. Now, like I said, the first layer is the base layer. Thermals, long sleeve shirt, and either my regular bib liners or some long johns. Just no cotton, I'm serious. You see, cotton absorbs sweat and doesn't let it evaporate. So 15 minutes into your ride, once you've all warmed up, your clothes could be soaked in sweat. Then when you stop, you're wearing wet clothes. In the cold. Not only will you be miserable, you also now have a serious chance of hypothermia. There's a saying, cotton kills. For real. So stick with the fabrics that wick sweat away from your skin. You'll be so much happier. Next is the insulation layer. Remember, we'll be riding, so the big puffy parka will actually be too much because we're generating a lot of heat as we ride. I wear a light to mid-weight fleece, and as I get warmed up, this seems to be all I need. My legs never seem to get very cold, so I usually wear my normal bike shorts with long underwear, or I'll wear a pair of these warm-up track pants. They were cheap and comfortable. They actually fit over my knee pads and have little drawstrings on the cuff so I can keep them out of my drivetrain. However, that's just me. If you think you need more warmth, try a pair of Expedition weight thermals under your shorts or your pants. They're nice and toasty. Another tip is, while you want the base layer next to your skin to wick away moisture, you will find that the looser fitting insulation layers are actually warmer, because it's the airspace between the coat and our body that's keeping us warm. Then finally, the shell. The shell layer is the layer that keeps the wind, rain, snow, and mud away from our precious insulation. A light windbreaker or a full-on waterproof rain jacket is what I use, depending on how cold and windy it is, or if there might be a little moisture in the air. Just make sure your shell has the ability to vent the excess heat you'll create with pit zips or back vents. Otherwise, it'll start to feel real clammy. Both the shells that I have can be stuffed into an inside pocket, making it a nice compact unit that can be stowed in my pack when I don't need it, or I just cram it in there altogether. Now we have the three layers covered, let's move to the hands, feet, and head. Starting with the hands, I have my normal full-fingered riding gloves, which 90% of the time are just fine, especially once I get my heart rate up. And then I have a pair of insulated gloves. They're also a little bit more windproof. I usually start out with these gloves, but as my level of effort ramps up on the trail, they start to feel a little too warm, so I carry both pairs with me. Now, the feet. Even if it's not wet outside, waterproof shoes are a great idea. The waterproofing tends to help keep the cold wind out too. But one mistake that I frequently see people make in the effort to keep their toes warm is to cram thick socks or a double layer of socks into their normal fitting shoes. It seems like that would make your feet warmer, but doing that will only compress your feet, keeping the blood from flowing freely. And it's the blood flow that keeps them warm. If you have a pair of shoes maybe a size larger than normal, wear those. Or see if you can loosen your normal riding shoes up to accommodate thicker socks. To tell you the truth, I just wear a pair of socks that are a little thicker than normal with my usual riding shoes. I don't worry about it. Yes, my feet do get cold, but I'm only going to ride for an hour or two, and as long as it's dry outside, even with the thermometer in the teens, it's not that bad. If your feet get really cold, take a second, get off your bike, walk around, stomp them, wiggle your toes. This will get the blood moving again and warm them up. Last but not least is your head. It's not factually correct to say we lose 70% of our body heat through our head, but the thing is, it feels like it. You will be surprised at how much lower a temperature you can tolerate if you have a warm noggin. Crank your helmet open to allow a skull cap, balaclava, or beanie, or a buff, or whatever you prefer to fit underneath. I don't like to have my face covered while I'm riding. It feels suffocating and it fogs up my glasses. I like to wear a skull cap and then use a buff around my neck. When we stop, I can pull that up over my mouth and warm my face. Now, once you're all bundled up, there are a few more things to consider. Namely, your hydration. It's cold, but you still need to hydrate, and it will be a little difficult to do that if your water is frozen in its bottle or tube. You have a couple options, the most obvious being to insulate your water bottle. There are insulated water bottles you can buy, or you can just make sure the lid is on good and tight, put the bottle on an inside pocket for a little bit while you're stopped, and it should warm it up enough that you can drink out of it. If you use a hydration pack, while the water in the pack might stay nice and liquid, it's the supply tube that's the problem. You can buy an insulated wrap for the tube, or you can make one like my friend Nicole did, or you can run the tube under your shell layer by either tucking it down the collar or wearing the hydration pack under the shell itself. You'll look like a hunchback, but hey, you'll have water, and that's what's important. A crucial point you need to remember is that in the cold weather, even though we're doing all of this to stay warm, you want to do whatever you can not to sweat. A little perspiration is normal and unavoidable, but a full-on flop sweat is no bueno. Take frequent stops and adjust your clothing as needed to maintain a comfortable temperature. You might even start your ride out being a little chilled, knowing that you'll warm up soon enough. As you go, if you get too warm, open your coat, let the cool air in. Undo the pit zips on your shell to vent the excess heat. Shed a layer if you need. That's why we wore layers, to mix and match to get the comfort just right by changing the combination. Take the shell off and use just the insulation layer, or use just the lightweight shell in your base layer. Play around with it. You'll find what works for the current conditions. My final tip is, if you have room in the car, bring it all with you. It's hard to say what the weather is actually going to feel like when you get to the trailhead. I bring a couple of different coats of varying weight. Same with the hats and gloves. It would suck to ruin a ride because the conditions were different than what you expected. Keep it all in a special duffel so you know you'll have it without having to run around the house looking for it while your friends are waiting for you. I hope you got some useful pointers out of this. My name is Cody, you're watching Lunch Ride. If you have any tips that I didn't mention here, leave them in the comments. Help us all out. If you liked this video, if you thought it was helpful, click like, subscribe, share with your friends. If there's something that you think I could be doing better, let me know about it. Until next time.